Cars in the realm of video games are under a different set of criteria than hero cars in movies. When studying, entering, or otherwise being of vested interest in the filmmaking world, the phrase suspension of disbelief pops up a lot. The filmmaker's job is to present a world in which anything that happens in the movie is considered believable. Superhero movies became successful because instead of making the world fantastical and new, Iron Man and Nolan's Dark Knight trilogy grounded their characters in a world that we could realistically recognize. Then you have subversions of a genre like Deadpool, where something believable is rendered unbelievable in order to craft a new narrative, and that's a different concept entirely. Then again, the Lord of the Rings trilogy works just as well because Peter Jackson and J.R.R. Tolkien rendered a world where halflings and walking trees can believably defeat dark forces. I know each of those examples are crudely and woefully underrepresented. To make it simpler, story creators focus on making the world believable so that actions performed within the confines of that world's laws is also believable. High fantasy and science fiction from the likes of Octavia E. Butler and Brandon Sanderson is believable because they're able to construct vast continents and planetary systems with rules and consequences for breaking them. But even though video games and movies operate under their own rules for how we participate as audience members, their similarities allow people like me to deconstruct different aspects to fit our agenda. In my case, it's cars in the world of entertainment. Video games run through a similar pre-production process as cinema. NetherRealm needs to craft stories and PvP experiences where characters can believably approach a conflict and resolve or progress that conflict via a linear fight path. These are hard games to sell. In fighting games, you either have to sell the story or the characters the player gets to interact with. When in an open world game, the heavy lifting of selling a whole new experience has already been done. Marketing just needs to say, hey target demographic, here's a whole new world that you can devote hours to and get lost in. That's why when World of Warcraft delivered their developer's notes a couple months ago, they focused heavily on this beyond the afterlife world of Xerath Mortis, and less on the main campaign's progression. With the first 10% of that video dedicated to an introduction and recap, the ratio of explained world building to story development is 1.4 to 1. There's more to selling a game concept than the last 5 sentences lead on, but I like keeping my video essays under 20 minutes. If you couldn't tell from the title, we'll be focusing in on World of Warcraft from here on out. The world has grown and evolved since the vanilla of years gone by. This is old news. Often when creators thrust themselves into different zeitgeists and hidden corners of pop culture, they qualify their experience by saying, for example, I've been playing World of Warcraft for 10 years straight. I have proof because Blizzard sent me the statue. I can't do that. I began playing during Burning Crusade years. By began playing, I mean that my brothers and I made free 10-day trial after a free trial. We sat right on that poverty line, so we weren't even participating in the current expansion. Wrath of the Lich King came out, and that was the first time we bought a subscription? At least we thought. We bought the game, but without the necessary expansions to continue playing with players that we joined. Then that month of game time ran out, and we were back to free trials. We were always enthralled by the cinematic trailers and lured into the fantastical. It wasn't until 2015, after I got married, that I could play longer than a month. I didn't even care about the expansions, I just wanted to get my dwarf paladin that I made nearly 6 years ago through the wetlands. But now I finally get to enjoy the concept of expansions, except to do that, it means I have to leave Azeroth behind. It kinda sucked. I wanted to fall in love with Azeroth. For years I had been getting sold on Azeroth, so as I'm barely into Korthia, I come to realize I don't have to play this way. I can stay in Azeroth where the game mechanics and design seem more familiar. All that to say, my disbelief was willingly suspended for years. I'm here for Azeroth, I'm here for Zandalari Trolls and Draenei. But this past month was the first time I played Goblin, and started in Kezan, and oh my goodness. My dwarf's profession was engineering, and Goblin and Gnome engineering is kind of ridiculous on purpose. We know this, it's the charm of the game in some aspects, but through Gnome Reagan, we've grown accustomed to the quirks associated with Gnome engineering from the early days of release. But this new zone and the wealth of design it contributes to the lexicon of Goblin engineering is just too ridiculous. Let's look at this hot rod. Whenever you enter Azeroth as a new race in those first couple expansions, you're either a farmer or hunter that has grown to join the fight against the Horde or Alliance or whatever flavor of exterior threat they come up with. This is where goblins start to deviate. You're this up-and-coming trade prince of Kezan who gets thrust into action because of Deathwing's Cataclysm. But before the cataclysmic event, you need to strut your stuff on this island, and one of those ways is by showing off your new company ride. You are not on the reluctant hero's journey. You're a rich goblin who needs to brag about how rich he is. Instead of proving your bravery by ridding the minds of kobolds or healing wells, you know what? We'll take a breath and try again. Starting with the quest, rolling with my homies, and going until the end of life savings where the island finally gets destroyed, you get the keys to the Hot Rod, a mount which helps tie together one of the more sprawled out starting zones of Azeroth. Hey, I made that toolbox. Regardless, on this vehicle we have a number of design aesthetics and functional elements. We have what appears to be a four-cylinder engine in a V configuration housed inside of a wooden barrel? That can't be right. This barrel-looking engine is behind a furnace of some kind. Are we supposed to believe there's a Rankine cycle going on as well? And what's on top of that? A jet engine? We have a singular hose going from what could be a radiator but no return line to actually circulate coolant through the engine. And then there's another singular hose going to the dashboard plate from that barrel? Then back to this furnace, instead of trapping as much air and using it in a Rankine cycle, it has three vents on either side since, you know, the stagnant coolant isn't doing anything. Rankine cycles are typically closed loop systems, but this thing is open in so many places. Then turning our attention back to the turbine engine, there's a belt at the fan, the front, which is routed through slots at the front of the furnace, meaning the jet turbine engine isn't trying to produce propelling power or thrust, but rather rotational power. At the same time, exhaust is coming from only the body of the turbine and routing over and under the rear axle. This is getting way too messy. Let's try to simplify it. I'm going to throw out the V4 engine. Yes, those screw heads definitely move like pistons on a crankshaft, but I think they're meant to work more like valves instead of pistons, letting pressure escape this volatile system. We'll instead refer to that section as just a maintenance access point, perhaps the transmission, or heck, maybe it's a transfer case which allows power to the front wheels. Actually, let's call it the transmission, even though I'm shaking my head as I do. In any case, let's stick with the furnace and turbine engine as our power plant for now. The furnace itself has three vents on either side, a flaw in design which allows internal energy to dissipate from the ideal thermal equations in a Rankine cycle. In a Rankine cycle, there is hot steam which spins a turbine in the usual scenarios. We'll assume that heat, that steam, is traveling through the mounting point of the turbine and over the blades of the turbine itself. Theoretically, there could be an outer ring and an inner ring with one acting as the propeller for the Rankine cycle and the other ring acting as the turbine engine's fan compressor, with the turbine having its own separate fuel from the furnace burning in the combustor. That could make this power plant's output augmented by the turbine's own energy generation, but no, I'm simplifying it, and we're going to stick to it. The car is powered by the turbine output of a Rankine cycle. Except instead of a turbine being mounted directly to the driving shaft, we can't really call it a drive shaft, the turbine is providing power to the driving shaft through a belt and pulley system. Most belt drive systems factor in a loss of power causing overall efficiency of just that aspect of the system to be between 90-98%. Fairly good, not as great as having the turbine on the drive shaft itself. And then we have this nightmarish statics equation of moments and reactionary forces which doesn't result in a well-designed system. We have what has to be a fixed support at the turbine's mounting plate, which is usually a compressive force, not only from the gravitational force of the turbine, but also the compression of mounting fasteners. And then there's the tensile force of the belt at one end of the turbine shaft, the fan side of the jet engine, meaning that the fixed support needs to act as both a compressive force at the front of the engine, a reactionary tensile force at the rear of the engine, and a reactionary moment to compensate for the shearing forces that will inevitably occur. It's not gonna last long. That tooth belt is driving a shaft that runs through the furnace itself before going through the four screw head barrel, which might be a transmission, which then delivers power to a differential at the rear wheels. It all still doesn't make sense now. Gosh, we still have so much to go through. Then there are these quad exhaust pipes, two on either side coming from the jet engine, which means that including the exhaust coming from the engine nozzle blowing into the heat shield windshield, this turbine has five exhaust outlets. Before doing so, they run through a wooden catalytic converter, but in a Rankine cycle, that exhaust spilling over a turbine blade is just steam, and since steam isn't orange or red, the steam would be running and condensing through those four exhausts, which also means it doesn't need a catalytic converter there. It's probably not meant to be a catalytic converter. Shut up. There are two more exhaust lines? I mean, the differential doesn't really line up. We're just going to forget that image mesh of the model exists there. Due to how this vehicle maneuvers on the continent, its dynamics and motion, we can see that it's obviously a rear-wheel drive vehicle. This is reconfirmed with the center tunnel going through the floorboard, meaning that of the two possible methods of providing propelling power, the Rankine cycle is providing most of the work through the wheels, which makes sense if we compare the color of flame ejected from the turbine at its hottest captured color to a color temperature chart. The flame is only reaching 2750 Kelvin. Obviously the chemistry doesn't line up, since color charts usually refer to the temperature of iron. It's a crude comparison, I know. Either way, the exhaust coming from the jet engine's nozzle must be the burnt fuel for the Rankine cycle, and therefore we can stop referring to it as a jet engine. We reduce this complex series of 3D forms from three different power plants to one Rankine cycle power plant. Either way, one engine, two engines, or three, exhaust from the nozzle will still burn your face clean off. To compensate, Goblin Engineering has provided not a transparent windshield, but an opaque heat shield with the wiper blade. If goblins are 3 feet tall, then this heat shield is no more than 1 feet by 3 feet in area. Let's say this heat shield works on Azeroth as designed, and it maintains a magic barrier holding steady temperatures on either side. Even so, most physical laws on Earth are carried over to Azeroth. Gravity is still gravity. Aerodynamics seemingly works the same. So we're going to also assume geometrical properties are also transferable. This heat shield, just ceramics of a rectangular make in general, will have load stresses at the corners, meaning that though all heat is centralized on the heat shield, the corners will wear and crack quickly. It's a mess, and we haven't even begun to think about suspension and braking. Hopefully those exist. Nope. There is neither suspension nor evidence of brake components. Though with physical or digital asset evidence to the contrary, the playable mechanics prove that brakes exist virtually, so we can then assume that drum brakes are mounted within the spoked wheels with very tiny drum shoes. With this easier, well, rudimentary more like, brake identification and lack of suspension, this is an incredibly odd go-kart. I mean, that's essentially what it is. While nice go-karts have suspension, most starter kits don't. As a go-kart, it makes sense to have those flags too. Typically, in real life, there are orange safety flags that are mounted for most off-road situations. Four-wheeler, dirt bike, go-kart, when you get into higher speeds on a series of hills with a group of friends, those flag markers come in handy. In-game, they're checkered, for some reason. Now let's talk about the exhaust routing around the rear axle heating up those tires. Consistent temperatures, like the hot rod is seeing with the Rankine cycle and all that entails, will cause the rear tires to wear quickly. But luckily, it's also unprotected at the front wheels as well, meaning that when the tires do eventually go, you'll likely need to replace all four at the same time. And while it is available knowledge that tires do heat and wear under normal circumstances, and even more so at higher brake decelerations, the exhaust is getting routed next to the sidewall of the tire. Heat and subsequent wear on one side would cause uneven wear across the tread and might cause the sidewall to blister. Let's go back to cooling the engine, which isn't something we normally care about in a Rankine cycle, since in those scenarios steam condenses through longer return pipes, and the higher the saturated temperature, the greater internal energy. But it is a concern here. Nowhere on the model was I able to spot more than the hose from the radiator to the furnace, and the hose from, yeah, let's go ahead and keep calling it a transmission, to the dashboard firewall. It feels so dumb calling it a firewall. Meaning whatever coolant is present, it's not a part of a circulating system, and will eventually boil, causing severe damage to internal power plant components. At least there are exterior lights that are up to safety code, right? I'm not going to pretend to know exactly how a vehicle like this would work in real life. I'm typically Alliance, and the mysteries of Goblin Engineering are a secret to me. Though I am under conversion therapy— nope, that's not a good joke. Though I am enjoying playing in WoW Classic as a Tauren Hunter. Actually, pretending to know how this vehicle would work is exactly what I just spent the last several minutes doing. What I mean is, if you were to craft a replica of the Goblin Hot Rod, similar to what we've seen with Halo's Warthog or Batman Arkham's Batmobile, a lot of the kit would be design frills with no provided function. Beyond all this crazy, ridiculous frivolity of mashed together parts, there's an innate beauty to its ugliness. Wait, no, the word is aesthetic. There's an innate aesthetic to its ugliness. It makes less sense than riding a rocket called the Uncrashable to the Badlands. It makes less sense than the Mechano Hog. It makes less sense than having a metal band around the side pieces when there's enough wood available with width enough for a front and back piece to a toolbox. It's stupid, but so are goblins. Despite the affable love this car gets, it's not a mount option for continued in-game use. There are, however, current and potential future mounts that give you a bit of the Hot Rod flavor. Yes, I'd be remiss if I went through all this effort only to leave out the Goblin Mini Hot Rod and Goblin Turbo-Trike. As a late precursor, there is no way that I can touch on every minute detail that exists in Goblin engineering. At the same time, me calling out fictional flaws in the Horde doesn't mean they don't exist in the Alliance. I'd just like to make that a separate video. So back to what we have available to Horde players to look at and touch. Since Kezan and the precious Hot Rod get blown to smithereens,
now my Wego kit is in even more smithereen!
We can't bring our Hot Rod over to Kalimdor or the Eastern Kingdoms, but in Orgrimmar, we can look at Frizzo Villamar's mini Hot Rod, which presents us with odd variations in spelling, but that's neither here and it's certainly not there. At one point, there were plans to make this a castable mount in-game, but as of patch 915, five expansions later, the Goblins have yet to sell one of their more prized luxury items. However, there is a three-wheeled version of the Hot Rod in the form of the Goblins' collection of trikes available through the trike dealer Cal Worthaton. While the base design has a barrel housing the turbine, the Goblin Turbo-Trike espouses many of the Hot Rod's design features. But there's no fan on the turbine engine, with no subsequent belt going to the furnace, meaning we have to speculate once more how it's transferring power to the ground. Design over aesthetics, I guess. It really warrants its own breakdown video, but let's face it, I think I've said enough. I'm no World of Warcraft expert, I'm not one of those players who have their monthly or semi-annual subscriptions auto-renew, but I do still find myself more enamored than maybe the most vocal of daily players. I love the fantasy genre more than superheroes, more than science fiction. Anytime there's a fully realized and thought out world that gets to be expressed visually, I want to be there for it. And when that world has a car, all the more enjoyment I feel. At the same time, I'm no engineering expert either. I've done my time in the halls of Purdue University, but that doesn't mean anything really. From my study in those 4 years and the refreshers and new research I went through in preparation for this video, I can say with 100% certainty that no one on Earth understands Goblin engineering fully. And while I loved riding around in my Hot Rod and showing off my prestige before Deathwing caused the world around me to fall, I don't think it's a great design. There's more that could have been done not only to the Hot Rod but to the Goblin race before bringing them out of NPC neutrality and into the fold of playable character. Anyway, thanks for watching, and I'll see you all in the next one. Thank you.